rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Trustee Hankins will not be here tonight. I need a motion to approve the minutes on September 12th.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes on September 12th.
In a second.
Joe?
Aye.
Dave?
Aye.
Fire chief's report.
The belts on the top of our ventilation fans broke this week. So Safeco, our HVAC vendor, come out and fixed the fans. So then while they were there, instead of paying for another service call, I just had to go ahead and read the furnaces for this winter. He is and everything. So we haven't had any maintenance to those since the station's been built. So.
Everything good?
So everything's good. So put that taken care of. We're in the process of transitioning our EMS reporting system over to a cloud-based system. If you remember when University Hospitals were here, they touched upon it. They paid for the system. They're overseeing it. So we're implementing that system now. Their medications and all that information we couldn't get before. So we'll be able to pull that up. And so instead of having to complete a whole report, a lot of the report we filled in as they pull up to the scene through this new system. And then I'm working on our workers' comp policies regarding light duty, annual physicals, the random drug testing that we do to help keep our premiums lower and then to submit that to them. And then our public education people are in the elementary schools this week doing fire prevention stuff. And that's all I have.
You've been pretty busy this week, haven't you?
Yeah.
You know, I know the Lions Club members were happy to get CPR training from
a great job.
Yeah. I want to pass that on to you.
Yeah, thanks.
Along the same lines, we have 23 fire hydrants that the county Portage Water, Portage County Water Resources took over. So we're out from under any fire hydrants now. As a township, where before we had a bunch, so they've accepted those. So that's good. Yeah, we've done that.
No.
Okay. And on. Road superintendent report. Bill?
Yeah, we got continued fog seal over the chip, and we were able to get Marks Avenue done, Queen Allotment, Forest Glen, Vogel, and Heron Creek were all completed. I didn't really receive any negative feedback on it. More did, better we got at it, so it was interesting. But I think it's going to be really cool.
Good product.
We are going to do footers at the cemetery this week. Those will be done by Thursday. And then at the park, I'd like to hire GBC design for the project. Cost is $4,050. And this is to replace the engineer that we had before.
So this has is this going to go through everybody went through before stormwater?
Yeah, EPA, he is the one that's going to make sure everything is where it needs to be.
And how's this going to, is this going to set us back with what's going on at the park now?
Shouldn't.
Okay. How long would it take him to get this completed?
Week
and a half. Okay. Does he have, are we going to provide him with any other data that we had prior?
Yes.
And then he'll prepare, fix, update, whatever needs done.
So any amendments that's done to the book that we everybody that has a book will be updated with the correct calculations.
And this will tie in with the operators union?
Yes.
Okay. They're not too far along where any of that would be.
They're still on top.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think we need to get professional people on this and make sure things aren't falling through the crack, things are not propagating.
Yeah. I'll make a motion to hire GVC Design Inc. At a fee not to exceed $4,050.
And they're doing
for engineering.
For engineering at the park.
Yeah. I'll second that.
Joe?
Yes.
Dave?
Yes.
Can I have this copy or do you need
this? Yes, you're good.
Mike. Speaking of, while you're talking about that, the Portage portable toilets that provide our porta potties at the park have been vandalized. I got a call from the owner of the company, $500 for the damage. Somebody took the door off the toilet, a lot of graffiti inside. Obviously, the owner was not very happy. Luckily, his insurance covered it, he's replacing it. Then, lo and behold, happened again after he placed it. So, I don't know what his deal is going to be next year for that. I know he said that he's going to change the way the anchors are. You know, not be strapped down, he'd be anchored from the bottom, so they won't get tipped over.
Strapped down now.
But yeah, Joe Biden, I noticed that. He was talking about just putting in two regular ones next year because they're harder to damage. That's something we're going to have to talk with him about. But anyway, that's update on that. You mentioned footers too. The Lions Club is donating the four benches at the park, and they wanted to know about how do we want to do that? Do we want to put footers in and chain them down, or is that something you guys could do? I mean,
absolutely.
You know, whether it's a base to put them on and secure them that way, or you know, just a little footer, whatever.
We could probably do either or.
Yeah. So they have four of them. They're recommending two of them at by the concession stand, the Gracie Field side, and two around the pond.
It's going to be like a
they're composite. Yeah. So they're in. That just need to be put together, and we need to kind of get with them.
Are they going to put them together, or are
we I think the Lions Club's going to put them together.
Yeah. They're going to get with the park committee and see where they're going to
put what?
They're going to get with the park committee and see where they're going to be placed, or they're going to get with us.
Yeah, she goes to the park.
Yeah.
The park commission, yeah.
We already accepted that donation.
Yeah, I believe we did, yeah. I just wanted to touch base with the footer part. That was a concern.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Is that something you'd want to do before winter or wait till spring or?
We're good for a few months.
Okay, so I mean we're ready to put those in place this fall then? Okay.
Last meeting we ordered the abandoned bike and let's see what we do, 96 cents a foot. I got the actual cost back today. It's going to be 98.9 cents a foot instead of the 96 cents that we thought it was. So we need to amend that. $2,450.
Okay.
For that, and then there was another pipe that I forgot to add.
That's resolution 136.
That's probably. Is that the total cost for the other? No. The total cost for the other would be $4,204.10.
I'll make a motion to amend resolution 136 to $4,204.10, not to exceed $4,204.10.
I'll second.
Dave?
Aye.
Thank you. That fog seal does look good. I've seen Heron Creek and I've seen Mars Avenue. Just so you guys know, it goes over the road, it makes it, looks like almost like a paint that goes on top of the road, makes it really black. It's supposed to add 3 to 5 years to a road. That's yet to be determined and seen, but at least that's the claim that they're making, and it's a lot cheaper than chipping seal and everything else.
Well, it's quite a bit of chipping seal, so in terms of black stuff.
A lot of advantages. Okay.
That's all I have to. Okay, moving on. Zoning inspector, report. What do you have for us?
All right. 15 permits since the last meeting?
15?
15.
Wow.
Two houses, two additions, one demolition, two accessory buildings, four sheds, one fence, one pool, and two signs.
Four sheds?
Yes.
Somebody's put a pool in that?
Yeah.
So, did Linran get completed, that demolition, do you know?
I don't know if it's all the way done.
Yeah, I know they were still working on it. Just wonder if you knew if it was finished. Yeah. I think they're still working.
Zoning commission had their public hearing last week. I don't have it typed. I'll have it typed for the next meeting. Yes, I do.
Okay. These guys have a file for it.
Okay. The prosecutor's reviewing a court case from a past zoning court case from 2006, I think. Property owners on New Milford Road. We have enough information that shows the property is going against the court order, so they are pursuing, I don't know the process, but contempt of court, however that works. Mark talked to the prosecutor today, so they're getting the ball rolling.
Okay, that the last court ruling was sometime this year, a couple months ago, wasn't it?
That's a different case.
Okay. For the same property, though.
Basically, they're handling it now, and if they need anything from us or from you, they will. The prosecutor's office.
Prosecutor. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
Thank you.
Anything else?
That's all I have.
All right. Moving on. Fiscal officer.
Okay. We need a motion to pay bills.
I'll make a motion to pay the bills.
Second that.
Aye. Next on my list is a resolution to accept the amounts and rates determined by the Budget Commission for 2018. Happens every year this way.
This is just our vote on millage and inside millage.
Inside and outside millage, the levies and so forth, and what they expect to bring into the year for us.
I'll make a motion to accept the amounts and rates determined by the Budget Commission for the budget year 2018.
It's not that we have a, we can make a change.
It's not that
no.
We have a choice.
I'll second that.
Joe?
Aye.
Dave?
Aye.
And the last thing on my agenda is talking about the local government funds. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I've been at several different meetings now, some with just the townships, and then a couple at least with the villages and the cities. And it appears that everybody wants everybody else to give up money. The stance that came from the township, I believe, appears to be fair to me, where everybody starts off with a base, and then they look at the population, and how many people are served, and it goes up from there. The two biggest money makers out of the whole deal are, of course, Portage County and then the City of Kent. The City of Kent doesn't want to give up anything more than 0.5% of money. When we looked at their, when they handed out their proposal, they were looking at the county to give out the most money, and then also the City of Ravenna to take some cuts. The village proposals, they were pretty much staying stagnant, and the money that was coming out, they were giving just a mere pittance, it seems, to the townships. So I have a meeting tomorrow night. I need to be able to inform the rest of the townships if we're going to stay with them and look at the base, the, doing the base with population base, or if not. I mean, we're free to say we don't want to go with that flow, or to go with it. But I will tell you that every email that I've seen and call that I've taken, the majority of the townships are going that way, and they want to stand their ground, because when it comes right down to it, all 18 townships have more population than all the cities and the villages put together. And they just feel like we've been cut short for too long. The last time this went into effect was 10 years ago, and they're proposing that this next time period be another 10 years. They've also said that, you know, instead of taking a hit right at the start, it could be a phased in thing, so that no one entity is going to be hit so badly. But in my opinion, I believe that we should stand with the other townships and try to get more for our people and for our township.
Yeah, I agree with that too. You know, I've been following them also as I went to a couple of those meetings.
Yep.
And I mean, when somebody gets over $700,000 and we're only getting $28,000, it's just, it's not equity. It's not.
How you justify it?
That, yeah, and I don't know how they justify it.
So pulls out some numbers and everybody
and I think
that. Wait for a decade, right?
And I think the township has a very fair way to try to get this remedy.
Mm-hmm.
Between the cities, villages, and the township. So, with the county taking it, without the county taking it. So
we're going with this now, then? This isn't final, but?
No, it's not going
to
be final.
You know, it doesn't, the plan doesn't have to be ratified until the end of this year.
Mm-hmm.
So there's more time for discussion. If the Portage County and the City of Kent are the only two that can say they won't take any of this, and if they don't agree to anything, then it goes to the Budget Commission, the County Budget Commission, and they're supposed to make some kind of plan. And if they choose not to do so, or they can't get ratification from the majority of the members, then it goes to a state prescribed plan. And I've been told, I haven't actually seen the figures myself yet, but I've been told that the figures on a state prescribed plan favor the county and hurt the townships the most. So I'm hoping that we can get to an equal plan for everyone.
You don't need a resolution. It's just
informative for you to let you know that, you know, as long as you don't disagree, I will go back and report that we're standing with the rest of the townships.
Yes, I don't disagree.
Correct. And that is all I have.
All right, we'll move on. Moving on to citizens' comments. The purpose of citizens' comments is to allow citizens to present information or raise an issue regarding items not on the agenda or regarding agenda items that do not include a public hearing. A time limit of 3 minutes per citizen shall apply. Please state your name and address for the record before you speak. We shall start. Let's go with the front row. Let's kind of keep it. Anybody in the front row have a name and address, please?
Jean Drain, GRAENING. Address 4885 Thelma Street. And this is just in regards to the new housing going in.
What new housing is that? Let's be more specific.
On Julie Street.
Okay. Independence House, or
yes,
whatever you want to call
it. Independence House. That's
yeah.
Right. just very upsetting to see that this has gone through, and no one has been had any idea in the community that this was going to happen. You know, being my age in a home that we just built 4 years ago, and to think now that since this is coming in, you know, commissioners and everybody are saying our housing, our property values are going to go way down. Now, I don't understand why something like this can be put in a housing development with single-family homes.
Well, the township was new. This is news to them, too. We had the township zoning applications put in. It was put in for a single-family house.
Yeah. Jordan, there was absolutely nothing mentioned as far as anything other than a single-family dwelling.
But then we're hearing that this is all said and done, and there's nothing in
right. The Ohio Revised Code 519.341 permits that to happen.
They're
against our zoning.
It's against us. They don't ask us anything. I mean, we talked out that night, and I mean, I know I think I sent you guys some emails along with it. They really tied our hands. They don't give us even an option to even have a voice in this. And then, you know, upon further research,
just takes
sense. Yeah, upon further research, you know, I mean, I got, I know there's a lot of cities fighting it, you know, and that's, I mean, I can name a few of them. You know, you got Stowe, North Olmsted, Columbus. You know, I mean, these are big cities that they're doing the same thing to. I mean, it's just a...
And also the Federal Housing Act also drops in on this, too, which is another hand-tying mandate that we have no control. I'm going to read this one section from this. It says, any person may operate a residential facility providing accommodations and personal care services for one to five unrelated persons and licensed as a residential facility that meets the criteria specified in Division B1B of Section 5119.34 of the Revised Code as a permitted use in any residential district or zone, including any single-family residential district or zone of any political subdivision. Such facilities may be required to comply with area, height, yard, and architectural compatibility requirements that are uniformly imposed upon all single-family residences within the district or zone.
So what that basically says, if you have a homeowners association, you have more teeth than what our just local zoning is.
Yeah.
I mean, it just, obviously I went up there and looked at it. I was with you guys. I mean, I don't, I wish that we had a voice in this somehow. You know, I wish that, you know, I mean, I look at that as when they're going to hire somebody that's going to be there 24/7, I view that as a business. Unfortunately, the federal government is saying it's not. The state backs them, and they mandate that on us. And that really is just a...
Hard to swallow,
like
but that's
yeah.
No, it don't.
I know. I understand.
You work all your life to have a beautiful home and stuff, and then within a minute of day, you know, time of days, you have all this happening. And then it's not that I have anything against people that are disabled. I work with disabled people in a school for 10 years. That's not the point. It's the point of all the other things that go along with it, as far as what you consider a disabled person.
It's very big.
You know, from what I understand in a lot of the other communities, it's been a disaster.
Yeah. I don't.
I've got grandchildren that live in there.
I do.
You know, and
yeah.
I worry about the safety for them also, and all the other children that live in there.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not going to give you a lot of, you know, I'm not going to help you out, but I know that we're still looking. I mean, we're not done looking. We're not done exploring every option, but I'm going to be honest with you, I'm running into a wall. I mean, every place that we're going to, I mean, Jordan, you know, we've been on the phone trying to search stuff out, and I mean, it's the same thing. I mean, it's, you know, they seem to have written this law that it's, you know, four separate people living in the house constitutes a family. I mean, it's not anybody else. You know, that doesn't fit anybody else.
Yeah,
but they say that right in the law.
Because
did you guys get the
in a licensed residential facility, that's why.
Who did I send it out to?
Probably, did you send an email?
Did I send that to you? Did you get it, George?
Yeah, I sent it.
Okay, yeah, send it, I mean, it kind of goes a little more detail about what we're allowed to do and what we're not. I feel for it.
All right, we'll move on then.
Okay.
I'll reserve my time.
I'm sorry?
I'll pass, I'll reserve my time.
Okay, well, you have your time, you don't pass, we're not, this isn't, okay? Next?
Not.
Yes, ma'am?
My name is Lisa Monahan, I'm the president of Sapwood Shores. I and my family have been members of this community for maybe 80 years as homeowners over on Muzzy Lake. I'm here on behalf of Sapwood Shores about the proposed zoning amendments. I have communicated with the trustees on behalf of our homeowners, and I've highlighted several issues that are of vital importance to us. I've invited the trustees to meet with us and have a site visit and understand. I think a visit is the best way to understand how some of these concerns that are written into the zoning code will play out. I already have an appointment with Mr. McIntyre with my committee for tomorrow night. I encourage you to come visit us at 6 p.m. tomorrow night.
Where?
At my house at 3979 Sapwood. You're welcome to join him if you're able to do so, or we can meet with you another time.
Yeah.
I have several of my homeowners and my board members here tonight. I could give you the detailed concerns now, or I could just refer you to my email. What would you prefer?
I mean, the email was pretty specific, and I think tomorrow, I mean, I know that I have some questions that I'm going to go over with you tomorrow, clarifying things. So, and I think they may clarify for both of us, honestly, looking at it.
Okay. And our most driving concern is the ability to rebuild and remodel. I mean,
have you talked to the zoning commission?
Yes.
Independently, or?
I mean, independently.
I mean, through your attorney.
Through our attorney.
Okay.
Who, for the record, our attorney represented all three homeowners associations.
Okay.
And I can share with you a chronology of what I understood our appropriate steps to be.
Mm-hmm.
We, for the record, we thought it would be a more practical approach if all three groups collected their comments and worked through one voice instead of having 100 people before you and before the zoning commission, everyone citing their personal circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why we did it the way we did.
Right.
And I can share with you that chronology later. But I encourage you to come down, and I hope that our absent trustee can find time to meet with us too.
Yeah, I'll email you. I'd like to schedule time too.
Okay.
Okay. So, because
right.
Personally, I mean, I'm totally interested in this, and I know we have three different lake communities, and they may all three be completely different, have total different uniquenesses.
Yes.
How I put that, you put in your email response the same way. We want to make it what works for everybody. It's not going to work, nothing's ever 100%, but if we can get it for Sapwood Shores, East Muncie, Sandy Lake, that we can get 90% of the, you know, people be happy. You know, that's our goal. The Zoning Commission didn't have a whole lot coming from the Muzzy Lake groups. It was mostly from Sandy Lake. So what they came up with was pretty much input from them.
And to go on with that, I mean, like, the things that I heard at the commission hearing, when I spoke to you guys outside, were quite different than what I heard inside.
Correct.
And I'd like to share that.
And we want to hear that too.
Yeah. We want to go through it. I mean, but just the initial concern of three different districts. The attorney, from my understanding, again, it's not, I don't know other than what I've been told, but the attorney expressed he only wants one district, not three separate districts. So that's
I think that could work, if it could work. I don't think it can work. I think there's too many differences.
But that came from your attorney, and I mean, now we're kind of.
Initially, we talked about having three districts.
We did, and so we were very surprised to see one code that was going to apply to all three. And we still believe that three districts would be in the best interest of the community. I don't think you need to worry about this proliferating. We are so unique that we are the only three communities in the whole township to which these zoning rules would apply. So it's not like you're going to end up with a bunch of other communities that are like us. And we look forward to the opportunity to work with you, and I look forward to the opportunity to share our chronology with you and set the record straight on some of these misunderstandings,
I think if we could get a foundation, basic Lake Community Foundation, and then you'll go off onto the other ones. Well, this won't work for us because we do have a road, but we don't. We have a private driveway. So, you know, how are we going to do that whole lot issue and, you know, all the little differences? That's what we're going to have to hash out. If you all, you know, that are involved in this are willing to work with us, we're willing to work with you. This is what we got to do. And this isn't going to be something that's going to be done in a week or in one meeting. It's going to be a work in progress. It's taken us 2 years to get this far. I think we hit some roadblocks, but since you're all here, I think that, you know, that's showing that, you know, we need to move this forward in a positive way, and I think it can. I think it will. I mean, it's as long as cool heads prevail and we just listen to each other, that's what it's going to take, you know. I mean, the community's been around a long, long time, and we all know that. I used to work down there on cleaning a cottage in the spring and the fall. Of course, I was 5 or 6, I didn't have much choice, but I still have fond memories going down there and getting in the lake and getting yelled at because you're not allowed in the lake, you know, from my dad. So so it is nice, and there have been, like you say, miscommunications. I think some people have been said, this is a private community, you guys aren't welcome down here. Others have said, when I brought that to people, I have other people say, Ron, you know, no, you guys are more welcome to come down here, you know, and look to see where our situation is. So, you know, I'm glad to see that, you know, let's open that up and have some dialogue and have some back and forth, because that's what it's going to take. You know, something might not work zoning-wise, you know, for certain reasons, and other things maybe, you know, well, why can't that work? So that's what we hope to continue on.
We'll start that tomorrow at 6 with that group, and I'm going to be honest with you, I've already done some homework on it, and I think I'm going to have some pretty good answers for you already. So just on the questions that you've already asked and addressed, I think you'll be happy with some of the things at least we come up with, or you know, zoning, you know, clarify some stuff for me, and I guess that was helpful. So.
Okay.
Now, I want to throw out there, too, that something else had come up from regional planning, and I don't know if the communities have been informed or maybe got glossed over, but whether to do platted lots or condominium style, that's a big question with regional planning. On the Regional Planning Commission, so at that meeting, this was hashed out that, you know, the amendment has got some good things and it's got some things that are going to be kind of difficult. So one of the things was whether the communities want to do platted lots or condominiums. So in their opinion, a condominium would probably be a better fit for y'all, but that's going to be for the communities to decide, not us.
Well,
so,
with all due respect, to the comments about how we apparently made a bad appearance because we retained an attorney to advise us on this, we can't even understand what that means without seeking legal counsel. But I do have to say that when we first formed our corporation for the purpose of acquiring the real estate from Mr. Navarrete, we did look at whether a condo association would work for us. And at that point, counsel told us, and it was not Mr. Cole, it was an Akron attorney. At that point, our counsel advised us that it probably would not be a good fit for us, and that was how we came to the structure that we are today.
Okay.
So, but I mean, I don't have any, I'm a wills and trust lawyer, so I have to have someone who's
To respond to your legal counsel, I have no problem personally with getting legal counsel. I mean, we all do that. I don't know the ins and outs of the legal system, obviously. And if that's what you guys decided to do as communities, that was fine with us, too. And we thought exactly what you said. Instead of having 100 people coming in giving us the same thing over and over and over, pass it to one person to represent you and that didn't seem to work so well. So, you know, let's take another tap or let's reboot, restart.
We got a meeting tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Yes, and just to clarify, I have a 5-page chronology of our attorney's efforts that I can share with you. I don't know how the communication broke down, because if you look at his chronology, you know, he was there on our behalf.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, I like to see that too. So.
Yeah, Tom Nichols, Ritztown, Harville Road. It was an issue that the lake communities weren't paying their fair share of taxes. Is that still an issue with you guys?
Not to me. That was brought up about the tax, but of course going to the auditors. Last I've heard, when I heard the auditor said everyone's paying their fair share, it hasn't been an issue as far as I'm concerned.
The auditor's the one that's going to assess tax value, it's not us.
May I comment on that?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
As a corporation, we are assessed the value of the real estate, and the corporation pays taxes on the real estate. Additionally, each homeowner pays a separate tax based on the value of their structure that is on the real estate. And as far as I know, the houses are appraised from time to time, just the same as everybody else, all the other tax-paying property owners in the.
That's what I figured, and it was communicated to me through conversations with the trustees that possibly you guys were not paying and your fair share, and I always was under the assumption that you were.
Yeah.
And, so I just,
well,
that was one of the stumbling blocks.
Thank you for asking about that, because if you look at either portion of the tax bill, maybe you would think that we weren't paying our fair share, but we do pay our fair share.
Yeah, I believe you.
And you're right, that was something that was brought up and looked into, and it was, of course, that could be the difference between corporation and individual homes too. So as a corporation, we're looking at different assessments. So yeah, that's not an issue anymore as far as I'm concerned.
I have a question for Billy.
No, it's about, no, we're talking about.
Oh, okay. Is the community, the neighborhood in Curtis and Kenneth Drives, would you say that's one of the most flood prone neighborhoods in?
We got an area behind. No, we've got a few of them.
Yeah, I don't know if that would be the most flood prone.
I mean, I know
that ditch behind there was built back there, hasn't been maintained, and that's been part of some issues with flooding on Kenneth, I guess it's coming up in Talmadge.
My concern is, you know, the park, which is now going to be an athletic field park, five separate fields with subsurface drainage, and there's like 2,400 feet going into one field. I just think that if you guys are going to do this, you need to get a more stream morphology study going and a hydrology study of the amount of water and the velocity of water coming through those black pipes down through the ditch to reed ditch, because I'm pretty sure that community on Curtis and Kenneth Drive is going to be affected by the amount of water collected from the subsurface drainage.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a lot, a large increase.
It's going to be a large increase
of water coming down through, because you're taking it from the subsurface and also from the surface and channeling through corrugated pipes.
It's not 3 minutes.
Down
the stream. Which goes through the same retention pond, which would go into a pond.
Correct.
It would go out the same pipe that it's currently going.
Correct. A 10-inch into the creek.
But that
all that water is being collected where it wasn't before. It's a farm field. It was percolating down through.
Mm-hmm.
Understand? So
why would it not be percolating down through?
Because of the subsurface drainage. It's collecting it.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Taking it
down through the drainage pipes.
Yes.
Instead of spreading out and going through.
So the increase in the volume of water is going to be exponentiated, and it's going to increase faster, more rapidly, and go upon that neighborhood. Which, you know, if you get the flooding, I'm just worried that, you know, that community could possibly sue the township and cost you a lot of money if you don't have a stormwater plan that is very good and well thought out.
Which is why we're going with the stormwater, Portage County Stormwater, with the engineer we just agreed to hire. And that'll all be brought up and taken care of, I hope.
And he's doing all the math on all the
correct.
Subsurface drainage and capacity and the volume of water.
That is what he's actually been taking all the elevations, figuring out how much is going to be put into a retention pond, the prior, before, and then the after.
Would a home association have stopped these people from building?
What I got from the attorneys that I talked to, and we had one in here, but from my understanding, you know, how you word it, and just like in how that law is put out there, they would have to build to your standards. Right now, looking at every house in there, the things that I see driving through, every house has a basement, every house has X amount of square footage that you know, is going to be required, you know, by having...
That couldn't stop him from building that. I mean, that couldn't have stopped him from having it as a group home.
Not as a group home, but it could have made him put a basement in, could have made him do the other stuff.
Now, is there a ratio? There's two more empty lots. Can he build two more?
Proximity type thing, you mean?
They're right there.
Right next to each other?
Yeah.
Something I read, I think there's only allowed two. I don't think that he's allowed to do more. Jordan, I know you read it also. Does that ring a bell? I thought there was something in there that said they could only do two.
I didn't read that in there.
But I mean, I'm not going to say it for 100% certain.
Yeah. Now, I was told that the commissioners didn't really know too much about it, but the way I understand it, they gave him a $90,000 low-interest loan out of a special fund.
That was through NDS? Was that through NDS?
Yeah.
It's through the revolving loan is where that...
Yes, that's exactly, yeah.
But I don't know, I mean, Joey, you'd know more than me on this. I think they started this process last year. I don't know that they necessarily said, or, you know, he applied for the money. I don't know that they necessarily said
what it was for
and where it was going to go.
I mean, how can that be possible? I mean, not anybody know anything about?
I think it's through a group, Independence Group.
Yeah.
Independence Group, and then the Independence Group funnels the money out to who they seem to.
I mean, he's got an empty lot in his development. He should have put that in there. That's it.
Yeah, I'm reading through this section of the... There is something about the concentration and all that. I just don't see it. So.
I think I read somewhere... In one structure, you can't have more than 17 people, and then it's considered like a nursing home, whatever you call them.
There's one for 1 to 5, and then 6 to 16. That's on the same section. One's under A, and one's under section B.
Well, he's going to get $1,100 from each from the state, from a grant. So he's going to make $4,400 on each home he's got there. Pretty steep rent.
And is this for profit or non-profit? I'm sorry, I'm going out of turn.
Yeah, you are. I didn't want to say anything earlier.
Can I go on his? I knew I should have sat by him.
Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. Heard anything?
No.
Ma'am?
I'm Liz Weimer, Sackwood Shores. I just want to thank trustees for being responsive to the zoning issues there.
Thank you for
communicating.
Yes, appreciate
you.
That. Ma'am? The Blues? Yes.
Oh, I can have my
hand. Okay. Let's move back, sir, in the fourth row.
Well, I'll just say thank you.
My name is Darren Beatty, B-A-D-E. I live at 2664 Sandy Lake Road. I'm the secretary of our board of directors at Sandy Lake Incorporated. So first, our board is appreciative of the work by the Zoning Commission required in drafting the new zoning regulations. We recognize that there are many situations in the new code that may still require variances, as pointed out in the Zoning Commission during the public hearing on September 19th. At that public hearing, however, we felt the intent of one particular regulation was not made clear to us. And because we feel this regulation may actually be problematic for both residents and the township, we ask that it be given close attention by the trustees. The regulation is 340.05E that states existing footprints shall now be considered non-conforming. Sorry, I'm not reading my own writing. That's why I wrote it out. I still didn't. Existing footprints shall not be considered non-conforming, but all new construction shall meet the setbacks as described in the section. Structures destroyed by natural disasters may be repaired or replaced subject to section 450.02D. That last section is titled Non-Conforming Structures Destroyed by Natural Disasters. So it appears that this creates a contradiction. The first part of the code considers existing footprints as conforming. The second part considers existing, or sorry, the second half causes the existing footprints to be subject to regulations of non-conforming structures. And further, this is unclear whether voluntary rebuilding or altering a structure that is deemed conforming, but not meet those new setbacks, and how those should be treated. So I think it's a very similar topic that residents from Muslim have mentioned.
I mean, I again, just like we did with her, I don't have a problem coming down meeting with you or a group of you. Mm-hmm. You know, we can do that separately. And honestly, some of this stuff is really good for us too, because, you know, when we're getting it, a lot of the legal mumbo jumbo, I don't always understand it.
Yes.
I mean, and so getting it clarified, and just like what you're doing here, clarifying it, then I can take it back and say, you know what, it don't make sense here. Can we clean it up?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. And we found some code from Kent's ordinances that I think would meet the intent, probably of Goodstown, and also I think some of the.
I think the part that you referenced, I think one of them was with the new district, the new Lake District, with the goal is to make everybody conforming now. Okay, but if you build new, now you have to comply with the current zoning. So that's I know that's a part of the issue with the square footage of the house and the two-car garage and all that. So that's something that needs to be hashed out as well.
And I think some of that might be relatively clear. I think the issue is if you say wanted to rebuild voluntarily,
right?
And that's just
that's something that I agree with you. I don't think that you should be held to live in a, you know, an 80-year-old cottage, you know, not in today's, you know, with efficiencies and electricity and, you know, old.
Before we make any promises or anything, I think it's just a matter of getting out and talking.
Yeah, we'd hash it out,
And we'd be glad to do that. We've done that with the zoning.
You want to hang around afterwards? Yep. We can exchange.
Sir?
I'm just going to say, I'm Mary Palmstrom. I'm the vice president of the Sandy Lake Corporation. And was going to extend the same thing you guys just asked, but we would love to have you come set up a time, so we'll try to make contact and try to find a date that works for part of our board members, and we'll probably do that.
Great. Do you want to just hang out?
Sure.
Yeah. Back row, sir?
Hi, I'm Barbara Soler. I'm a resident of East Muzzy Lake, and I am the secretary of our corporation. I reside at 4001 Hardin Road, Ravenna Township, Ravenna mailing address. And like to try to keep within the 3-minute time limit, I'd like to say that we appreciate everything that has been going on for the over 2 years here that has been happening. And we too would like to extend a welcome to schedule a visit to come down and to go through East Muzzy Lake to see our uniqueness and everything. And also, we will have some preparation, you know, things that are big questions for us that we'll submit to you ahead of time so that you can be prepared for it and stuff like that.
And the same thing, like,
very similar to Chaplin and Sandy Lake here, yeah.
Yes, my name is Cheryl Dempsey.
Can you speak up, please?
My name is Shirley Tencio. I reside at 5240 Mulford Road. May I please approach the table?
Sure.
I have some articles. Yes, I've been fighting this for a year now, since 6/22/16.
What?
You'll see. This is your, the zoning's court agreement back in 2001.
Oh, this is dealing with what George Brog began with? Yeah.
Yes, but, sorry, this is the revised, and apparently he went to court and had it revised and made bigger in 2006. And I never complained as long as it was behind this agreement, behind the fence. Even though he double stacked it, that's what he, and I still didn't bitch when you could see it above the fence. But he was approved another large building just recently.
When recently?
He would know.
Within the last
on
year?
The house?
No, another big barn out back.
I thought that that's what we were saying, no.
And he, no, I was told he was approved.
Okay.
But
are you familiar with this?
Yeah, there was a variance granted 2 years ago. It has since expired.
Okay.
That's not what I was told.
Okay.
I was told it was good and that.
I believe.
It all started with the convoy of trucks sneaking in the blocks last year on 6 when I called zoning.
Okay.
It stopped. Bulldozers, everything. I was told it was still good and would be good for the future, that he just didn't get a permit. This is what I'm living next to. The fence was laying in my field for 2 years. I begged him and begged him. There's where the fence is supposed to be. But when he pulled all the cars out, and the fence has never been upkept. And it's like 6 inches off the property line, so he refuses to fix it unless I let him come on my property.
Well, I mean, I'm going to tell you here, I mean, right now it is a court case. It sounds like it's in the prosecutor's.
I talked to the prosecutor just 3 months ago, and he said there was nothing he could do if zoning didn't enforce it. I talked to that gentleman when he got this paper, and I asked him, and he said, I put it in the file.
Well, but did you see this right here?
No,
I guess
not.
Because it seems like it, this is not late, you're just...
I've been being told contradictory.
Well, 3 months ago, the permit might not have expired. It expired at that point.
Okay, yes.
So now it is expired. And from our understanding here, and this is from the prosecutor's office and all, it is going.
Okay, I just know,
so.
I'm getting sick sometimes,
yeah,
and I can't get to these meetings.
Yeah,
but
so.
For a whole year, I've been told, no, it's when he gets a permit. I'm happy as long as he was abiding by keeping the...
Correct.
Now, by this ruling in 2006, he was supposed to put a fence up all the way around his property.
What I'm going to ask you to do is give a copy of these pictures. I don't know if we can have a copy or if we can get a copy, or maybe we can scan them if we can get them to zoning so that they could put it with the file they've already got going with them.
My friend did some pictures.
This that she gave me is from the health department. This is what I was asking about earlier this year. This is what I was referring to, that they... It's given him 30 days to clear the solid waste.
Now the health department has reneged on that. They said, oh, it took him 30 years. We're going to allow him. And I said, well, is a year good enough? So I'm going to see the head lady of the health department tomorrow.
Okay, good.
Because, I'm trying to be patient, but it's good.
I know, I understand.
And
I think at this point maybe it is worth a conversation, at least with Jordan, again, just to see the update. He can give you maybe a copy of what we're currently going through and the file, so.
Okay.
Sure.
Yes.
That's not our fault.
Oh, okay. I've never done this.
Yeah,
so
that's
fine.
That's fine.
Do I have the other court?
Yeah, I think it's inside here.
So what should I, what do I do from here?
I would just talk to Jordan. I think
about contempt of court and all that, and that's, that was dealing with, you know, that case, so. But again, 3 months ago, they're not in there, right?
I'm trying to keep up with this in between hospitals.
That's what I'm saying, instead of, you know, 3 months ago, there was nothing, you know, but here, there is something completely different now, and that's all, just maybe talk with him even afterwards and explain to you what's going on or what's changed.
And then if.
And then if you're not happy, then you come back.
Okay, absolutely.
Okay, thank you very much for being patient.
Thank you. Who's next, Mike?
Back row, Jim?
I'm good.
Hey, moving over, moving over.
Yeah.
Moving over. Ready? Anything?
No problem.
Going? Got us all in the back corner? Nope, Roger?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay, about there. Everybody else back there? All right. All right, oops. All right, we'll move on then to old business, trustees' old business. Do you have any old business today?
Not today, not, can't wait till next week. I have some old business, and I know I have it stashed in here. This is dealing with the park. Back to the park, everyone's favorite subject. We made a resolution. You know, I don't have a paper either. I thought I brought that with me, and I don't have that from, about getting a professional company to write up a master plan for our park. We made a resolution 2 years ago that we would do so. We do have a company that has come to us, has talked, I believe, to the park commission as well. Environmental Design Group. She actually and gave us a this presentation. But they have a plan to help with, I don't have all the, I hate to, I don't want to send this on the next meeting, but I'm going to have to. A plan for $2,500. I don't have all the listed things, but they would help us with our elevations, where we place things, the ins and outs, professional things. They actually work with Beaver Excavating. Am I using the right name? I always get those guys mixed up. So Beaver actually recommended them. So I want to throw that out there. So I want to put that on an agenda for the next meeting when I have my information, which I thought I had with me. So that's only that part. So anyway, moving on then. I have nothing else to hold with this. Right. New business?
This is just something to think about here. I had Bill call Dave Saltzman from Detect Alarms with all the damage and stuff, the mm-hmm. stuff going on down at the park. He can put a security system up or a DVR with five cameras down there and run it pointing in different directions. And I'm thinking with all the stuff that's going on down there, it might not be a bad idea, especially with kids getting in there after hours or adults getting there, don't know. But I don't know that it's necessarily a bad idea. And maybe we can discuss it or maybe we can just move on. But he's got an 8-channel DVR hard drive, 3 terabyte. He's got 5 cameras, he's got a monitor. All that would end up being $2,395 for the equipment.
What kind of camera? Those high-rise night vision and all that too?
Yes.
Nice and
night vision. Yep. So, high zoom lens. So, I mean, there's some, you know. You know, I just think we're getting to a point where I think it was even less than a month ago, you had somebody kind of down there with the cheerleaders, a guy that was an unknown person, let's just say.
there a monthly fee on top of that? Is it set up in every month or?
It's ours.
Okay. We don't even have it, correct, you know. I think it's good, yeah, that we need to have something. We'll replace it, how far the cameras will pick up and how clear, I mean, we need to have something to be clear if we need something like that.
The next question, I guess, Joanne, would be okay. Do we, as budget wise, 24?
23.5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Be okay with that?
There's money in the park budget for that.
Okay.
This will be, this is, yeah, we don't need that more than 16. So I'm gonna make a motion to take Detect Alarm Systems quote of $2,395 to provide one eight-channel high-definition 3-terabyte hard drive, a Sony high-zoom camera. One Sony high-zoom camera, 4 Sony eyeball cameras with night vision, and a 22-inch monitor. At a cost not to exceed $2,395 for the park.
That's installed.
Installed.
That is installed, correct?
Correct.
And my desk, where's the monitor and all that stuff? No, I'm saying how it protects.
Protected
in waterproof case and all that, obviously.
Okay.
All right, I'll second that. That's actually a pretty good price.
Dave?
Yes.
Joe?
Aye.
And that's all I got from the business.
I don't have anything else, so we'll adjourn the meeting, 6:35.